Hi, everyone. Please welcome here at the last talk of the Security Dev Room at this FOSDEM conference. And please give warm applause to Peter Czanik. Or is it okay? with this talk, what you most likely did not know about Sudo.
Hi, good evening. Can you hear me? Okay. So, first, let me give you a quick overview of what I will be talking about. I will try to define what is Sudo, even if most of you use it all the time. Give a quick overview of interesting features of Sudo, from aliases to plugins. And finally, I will show you what is coming up in Sudo 1.9. A beta is already available for this. So, what is Sudo? I didn't know much about Sudo, just like everyone else, up until about a year ago, when I learned that Todd Miller, maintainer of Sudo, became my colleague through an acquisition. So I started to learn about it, and I was quite surprised how much it knows. And then I started to ask people at conferences and different events what they know about Sudo. And I got quite interesting answers. Most of the people answered that it's a tool to complicate life. And well, you have the root user, so why not log in as root, or why not use SU? So it's a valid answer, especially from desktop users. But even the most seasoned administrators often answer that, well, it's a prefix for administrative commands. And only very few answered that you can see who did what, or even more advanced features. So what is Sudo? At least according to the Sudo website, it's an it allows system administrators to delegate authority by giving certain users the ability to run some commands as root, another user while providing an audit trail of the commands and their arguments. So a lot more than just a prefix, as you can hand out permissions pretty much fine-tuned, and a lot more, as you will see soon. It can even help you to get a sandwich, if we can believe XKCD. So if you take a look at the basic sudoers file, you will see a line like this, that members of the wheel group can do practically everything. The columns in this case are who, where, as which user, and which command can be executed. Of course, it's pretty good as a basic configuration, as at least you see in your log messages who is doing what. But most likely, you will also want to limit your users, what they can do. And once you have more users, more commands to limit, and so on, then you will start to to create lists. And you can replace any of these columns with lists, a list of users, a list of hosts, and so on. But after a while, it's getting a bit difficult to maintain, and this is where aliases come handy. Using aliases, you can replace lists with aliases, which can simplify your configuration and make it a lot less error-prone. Just think about what happens when you remove a user from most places, but not everywhere. If you have a single list to maintain, then it's a lot more easy. So here are some examples. A host alias with web servers, a user alias with administrators, and a command alias to reboot your system. Sudo comes with a huge list of defaults. You can change it with the defaults setting in your configuration in your sudoers file. Here are some examples to override which path is considered secure, which environment variables to keep, or if you want to insert your users. Actually, the this line here means that it's disabled for users. But you can be a lot more specific in your configuration. In this case, insults is enabled only for the wheel group. So what are insults? Seasoned sysadmins know it. Remember this even if it's not a default setting anymore. If you mistype a password, sudo can print some funny messages. But myself, I just laugh on it, but some people are more sensitive, and as these messages are not always politically correct, these are disabled now by default. Digest verification. You can store digest of applications in the sudoers file, meaning that anytime you start a command, sudo compares the stored version with the freshly calculated version of the digest and can prevent modified binaries from running. Maintaining this in the sudoers file can be quite a painful thing. On the other hand, it gives you an additional layer of protection. Another lesser known feature is session recording. Anything happening on your screen, you can record it. Actually, it's called IOLOG, as input and output can record it as well. And of course, it can also play it back, just like a movie. So even if you have to hand out shell access to your users, you can see what is happening, which comments were executed. These recordings are difficult to modify, unlike syslog messages, as they are not stored as clear text. On the other hand, if you have, if a user has too much permission, they are easy to delete, as right now they are only saved locally. But stay tuned. Starting with version 1.8 of sudo, it's based on a plugin-based architecture, which means that even the most basic features of sudo are implemented as plugins. And you can extend or replace sudo functionality with your own code. There are both open source and commercial plugins available for sudo. Here I want to show you just one among the, from the many. It's called sudo pair, which can make sure that no user can enter comments on their own. There needs to be another user who approves the comments. The approver can watch in a terminal what is happening and terminate the session if something suspicious on the screen. On the other hand, this plugin is developed in Rust, which is a kind of difficult to package. It's difficult, but I have it here. So let's see how it works. When I entered my password, it prints a sudo approve and two numbers. The numbers are a user ID and a process ID, and the approver in on the left-hand side terminal needs to enter these numbers. So let's see. And this time I decided to reject it, and no harm was done. Oops, sorry. So this is what I wanted to show. So let's go back to the approved situation. Yes. So let's do something. List files, and then entering a nice command on the right hand side. what the left-hand side, the administrator who approves and follows the session, I don't want to happen. So quickly hits Control D on the left-hand side, and when the poor guy on the right-hand side tries to erase my laptop, well, I hit Enter, but nothing happened. I'm kicked out. So let's go back to my talk. And my laptop is not erased. A bit about configuring Sudo. The configuration is stored in etc sudoers, and you should not edit it directly, but use vi sudo. If you don't, as it does syntax checking. If you don't like vi, you can easily replace the editor using the editor environment variable. When you are experimenting with sudo, learning how to configure it, make sure that you know the root password. Yes, even on Ubuntu. As it's quite easy to create a config which is syntactically correct, but when you save it, you are not able to do anything anymore. The configuration itself is read from top to the bottom, so you should start with generic settings and add the exceptions at the end. Here is a typical sudoers configuration. I just removed the comments from it. It's from CentOS. It's you see that lots of defaults are changed. Then the usual root and the wheel group can do everything. And then here we change a few stuff. First, we enable inserts for the wheel group, but disable it for everyone else. And log output means that we do session recording. There was a common mistake on the previous in the previous configuration. What is it? What do you think? Yes, you should switch the two lines. As this way, you enable inserts for the wheel group, but then disable for everybody. So it's not what you wanted to do. Obviously, when you have more than one machine, you want to do some center management for your sudoers configuration. Pepit, Ansible, Chef, Salt, whatever. All have some support for sudo configuration, but all have some kind of limitation, like the configurations are not updated in real time. If your users have shell access, they can edit the sudoers file, so users can modify the settings locally, and often not. They don't do proper error checking, which means that you can easily lock yourself out. There is a possibility. There is another possibility for central managing sudo that you can store configuration in LDAP, which has the advantage that the configuration propagates in real time. And it cannot be modified locally as it's stored remotely on a server. On the other hand, it has quite a few limitations, like you cannot use aliases, and if your LDAP server is inaccessible, then you cannot use sudo. So it's up to you what you use. An important but often overlooked feature of sudo is logging and alerting. Sudo itself can create you email alerts based on the configuration when you want to receive alerts, and it stores, it logs all events to syslog. Just make sure that your syslog messages are collected centrally, otherwise it's easy to delete them. If you are using syslogng for collecting sudo log messages, then sudo logs are parsed automatically, so it's very easy to create alerts based on sudo messages and sent to Slack or Splunk or many other cloud services. If you are lucky, then you will never have to use debug logs, as these are used to debug sudo rules or to report problems. A few words about syslogng, as I'm coming from the syslogng team. It's a logging daemon with a focus on portability and high performance central log collection. And my initial advice to, when it comes to configuring it, that don't panic. It's simple and logical, even if it looks difficult at first sight and often at the second time as well. It has a pipeline model with many different building blocks, sources, destinations, filters, and so on. And all of these can be connected together using into a pipeline using log statements. Here, just to scare you, a very simple configuration, which is pretty generic for var log messages. The configuration starts with a version number. You can comment in it, have some global options, and here we have the building blocks I mentioned, a source, a destination, and the filter. And finally, a log statement which connects these together. Now to the sudo bits. Here is a filter to filter on sudo messages. File destination to store in JSON format, so you can see all of the fields parsed from log messages, and destination to send log messages to Slack. It's pretty easy. You need to know only a URL, and that's all. And here is the heart of the configuration. I mentioned that sudo logs are automatically parsed by syslogng, so there is no parser in this configuration. But in the log statement, you see the source, the sudo filter, and if my username appears in the subject field of the log, then the log is sent to Slack. And here you can see a nice screenshot, and any sudo comments executed by me are visible here. So you can follow in real time what is done by your users. So what is coming to sudo 1.9? It's still under development, but some of the features are already ready and ready for testing. The first one is the recording service. The audit plugin, using the audit plugin, you will be able to get any log messages out from sudo, but it's not a user visible feature, but something you can use from your own plugins, from Python or from C. The approver plugin framework is something similar to what you have seen in the sudo pair demo, that you will be able to approve sessions from within from sudo without any external applications. And my absolute favorite is that you can extend sudo with Python scripts. So what is the recording service? I mentioned that if a log is stored locally and you give too much permissions to your users, then they can delete their log messages, but not with the recording service, as anything happening on the terminal is streamed in real time and securely to the recording service. It's convenient, as you have a single place to view all of your sudo sessions. It's also availability, as even when the sending machine is down, you can check what happened there. And it's also security, as users cannot delete their traces. Python support means that you can extend sudo using Python. The plugin embeds a Python interpreter. It is using the same API as the C-based plugin. You can see the documentation, the URL to the documentation. The difference is that with the C-based plugins, you need a development environment, and it's quite difficult to package and distribute these. If you write Python code, you can easily distribute that code even with your configuration management system. And there is no need for a development environment, compilation, or whatever. Let me give you a quick demo of this. Here on the left-hand side, you can see a very simple Python code, which practically checks, receives, it's based on the iLog, or session recording part, that it receives all of the what is happening on screen, and you can match if my secret is appearing on screen and break the session if it appears on the screen. And here, under the root directory, I have a directory called do not enter, and under that I have a directory called my secret. And let's see what happens if I, on the right-hand side now, start sudo, change to the root directory, list it. Oh, there is a do not enter directory. It's definitely interesting. And sorry. So, as you could see, sudo is not just a prefix, but a lot more. 1.8 had fine-tuned permissions, lots of fine-tuning possibilities, session recording, LDAP-based configuration, and plugin support. And 1.9 will extend it a lot more with new APIs, central session recording, and a Python plugin. And do you have any questions?
Hi. Why on some setups, like for example, standard Ubuntu on AWS, whenever you do a sudo, it has to resolve your your host name, and if it doesn't match, it has to wait for the timeout?
Let's come back somewhere here. At the very beginning, all rules, or at least most of the rules, have a hostname check in it. Even if it's all, it means that it's checking some hostname.
Couldn't it not check if it's all and bypass that?
There might be an option for it. Actually, I never had to use it, but I can check it for you.
Thank you.
And if it's not there, I will open a feature request us, and it will be implemented soon, I guess.
Thank you.
You are welcome.